from Luke 2, 1 through 20. It's on page 857 of your pew Bibles. In those days, the decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria, and all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was one of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. And in the same region there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord showed around them, and they were filled with fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you, that you will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them.
Thank you, Andrew. I hope you keep your Bible open there. And Luke 2 is we're going to be looking at that again in a moment here. But we've been doing a Advent that has been a little bit different with the theme of Christmas over the rainbow. An idea that hit me as I was thinking about this Christmas time and the focus of how to love the Lord our God this Christmas time. We've talked about our minds, and now we're talking about hearts, and it made me think of a scene from the movie Wizard of Oz. And Wizard of Oz was something, and I shared this in my first message with you, but I'll remind you, maybe you weren't here, that for many of us, it was an event. It was something that came on between Thanksgiving and Christmas time, and we finally got to see it on TV, pre-VCR, pre-DVD player. And so this morning, we're going to be talking about having Christmas hearts, and it goes back, we're going back to a scene now where we're Dorothy and the Scarecrow are making their way down the yellow brick road, and they come to actually an orchard of apple trees, and they find out that those apple trees aren't very happy that they're trying to eat apples off of them. And so somehow the Scarecrow gets it to the point where they get the apples that they wanted by not having to pick them, but by making the trees mad enough to throw apples at them. And as an apple rolls, and it hits something metal. And here we come to the scene where they meet the Tin Man.
Did that hurt?
No, it feels wonderful. I've held that axe up for ages.
Goodness, how did you ever get like this?
Well, about a year ago, I was chopping that tree when suddenly it began to rain. And right in the middle of a chop, I rusted solid. I've been that way ever since.
Well, you're perfect now.
My neck. Perfect? Bang on my chest if you think I'm perfect. Go ahead, bang on it. Beautiful.
What a nickel.
It's empty. The tinsmith forgot to give me a heart.
No heart?
No heart. All hollow. When a man's an empty kettle, he should be on his mettle
And yet I'm torn apart. Just because I'm presuming that I could be kind of human if I only had a heart. I'd be tender, I'd be gentle, and awful sentimental regarding love and art. I'd be friends with the sparrows and the boy who shoots the arrows if I only had a heart. Picture me a balcony, above a voice sings low.
Wherefore art thou, Romeo?
I hear a beat. How sweet, just to register emotion, jealousy, devotion, and really feel the part. I could stay young and chipper, and I'd lock it with a zipper, if I only had a heart.
I'm a little rusty yet.
Let's go back to the loop passage here before we do that. Let's pray. Father, I ask you, some of us have become rusty. Some of us have a heart that's cold because something you notice that as Andrew read through this account here, we start off and Caesar Augustus, I don't know if you knew this, but they had given him the name Augustus. His name was actually Octavian. And the Senate had called him that, the Augustus. And he was literally called the savior of the world at the time. He was bringing in the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome. And so people were focusing their attention. And isn't it interesting that the true Prince of Peace shows up just while this other Savior of the world is here? And so we read this story and we've heard it. We've heard Linus tell it to us every year, all right? And we come to this end part here, and I want you to focus your attention on verse 19. It says, "But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart." Now, what that must have looked like, that's much deeper than if you look earlier at how people were responding in amazement, whether it be the shepherds with what they saw. You think about the light show that they saw that night, okay? That probably went too quickly. get there, and then they have truth. They realize that this wasn't just a dream. We weren't faked out here. We come and we see this, and so they get a boldness to go about, and they're excited about this. But this pondering of Mary, what that must have been like, what must have been going through her mind. Think about this. She could have been a 13 or 14-year-old girl. She's looking into a feeding trough, and she's seeing there's a baby that came out of her womb. That's amazing enough to begin with. But she's never known a man. This baby is conceived and born without ever knowing a man. This is the Son of the Most High God. This baby is the rightful heir to the throne of King David. This baby is the Savior of the world. And a mother is pondering this. What must have been going through her mind? When is he going to grow up and start saying things to the world of a deep doctrinal and theological mindset? Is he going to do miracles? What's going to happen with him? And you moms, I've never been a mom. Just being a dad, I'm pondering things. What you moms must think about as you hold those newborn babies. Will I have a normal relationship with this child? Will I nurse this child like other mothers do? Will I raise this child like other mothers do? Well, what's he going to be like? What's he going to be like? When will he set up his kingdom? When's this going to happen? She must have wondered a bunch of things. She must have even wondered about discipline. About setting an example for him. How do you set an example for God? What must have gone through this mother's mind? This is what I'm talking about. She pondered these things in her heart. She's feeling this, my friends. She's deeply involved in this. And later on, if you keep your finger there in Luke 2, 19, it may be on the same page, but we get to verses 34 and 35, and Simeon comes up to him and says to Mary, "I hate to tell you this, Mary, but this child is going to pierce your heart like a sword. It's not going to all be wonderful for you. This is going to be a very painful you having your son." This is days after she's given birth. This old man comes up to her, an old man that has been promised that he's going to see the coming of the Messiah, and she's holding Messiah, and he goes, "Oh, by the way, this is going to be painful for you." You're thinking, parenting is hard enough. She's the mother of the Son of God. And it's a painful thing because she already loves him. She must have loved him like no other mother has loved him, loved a child, because this one was perfect. And yet she's the one who saw him suffer. Remember that as we work through the story? We see that around Easter time. Eventually, she was there to see her little baby grown up, nailed to the cross. So she must have been thinking about a lot of different. She must have had a lot of stuff on her heart. So, let me ask you this morning, where's your heart as you ponder these things? See, we don't want to live passive lives. We long for our lives to be filled with fascination, don't we? I mean, we want our hearts to be consumed by stuff. Isn't that the case? He's put this desire in all of us. Think about how many things, if you've ever stopped to think about it, how many things people consume their lives with, their hearts with. they're looking for things. People are looking for things to captivate them. They want a sense of fulfillment. Here's the thing. When Jesus lays out the most important commandment for mankind, he starts with loving the Lord with all of our heart. And continues on. Look at this. Mark 12, verse 30. And you shall love the Lord your God with all, look at what he starts with, all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. Now, whenever you meet people, there's people that you and I come in contact on a regular basis that don't do this. We don't do this. We're here. You're here today. You're at church. But let's face it, isn't there a bunch of stuff that grabs our heart? And you and I come in contact with people all the time that have no interest. And this is the commandment of the Son of God for us. This is your job. This is my job. I'm supposed to love God and love people. Those are the two things. And he wants us to do it with all of our heart. But let me ask you, if it could be, metaphorically speaking, you were made of tin, and somebody banged on your chest. And the scarecrow's happy. He says, oh, what an echo. Right. But I don't want an echo. I want a heartbeat for God. So how do we love God with all of our heart? How do we do it? Point number one, if you're taking notes. Point number one. Our hearts determine our devotion. So what is the heart all about? The arena of the heart contains powerful emotions and affections and desires. And these affections are current, like currents, and they steer our lives. Think of it like a rudder of a ship or a boat that literally directs it. And to determine where our affections lie, we are to discern what occupies. Now think about this. I want you to think about this. What occupies your time? What motivates your actions? What shapes your aspirations and dreams? And the rewards that come down the road. You see, our affections, they want to be captured. And they long to cling to someone or something. And wherever these affections are found, it's where our hearts go. Point number two, our hearts, and this is crucial to remember, our hearts follow our treasures. The devotions of our hearts are determined by wherever we find value as our greatest treasure. Matthew 6, verse 21. Story. treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. So in order for the heart to love Jesus completely, it has to treasure him supremely. Our affections are the outcome of what we treasure. And when we truly encounter the Lord in his glory and worth, loving him with all of our hearts will be the end result. And so I don't know if that's ever happened for you. I have moments of that. You ever have moments where something hits you theologically and doctrinally? Some of you are like, just those words scare you. I don't want them to scare you. They're beautiful words. Because we have theology all the time. We have doctrine all the time. We just wouldn't call it that. But how we view stuff has a lot to say about our theology. Because it's what we think of God. How we view this stuff says a lot about what we believe doctrinally. And so we keep coming back to verse after verse after verse where God says, I want it to be a heart thing with you. I want you to love me. And how I get you aware of that is I want to show you what I've done for you. Every letter written by the Apostle Paul, the first half of it is all about what God has done for us. The second half is, now here's what you can do with that. And by the way, I'm helping you even with that. He doesn't leave us empty-handed or empty-hearted. So point number three, how can I love God with all of my heart? Make Jesus your greatest treasure. And if he isn't, ask that that would be the case. And what's really cool, what I've found in my life, I'm not that old. A lot of you, I understand that every time I spend time with old guys, they go, ah, you're just me. Not that old. But what I found is everything that I have treasured in my life that has taken over my heart, that when I've given it up, where I've said, this thing, it really isn't going to give me the true desires that I thought it would. When I've given it up and over to him, he's got this amazing way of taking that thing and giving it back to me many times, but I have a different viewpoint on it. Anything. And then, what's amazing is, he's given me the capability to use that for his glory. So let me ask you this one. Because if those things are your greatest treasure, if those things are your greatest treasure, they're going to let you down. Guaranteed. Oh no, my grandkids would never let me down. Oh yeah? Wait. They grow up. It's just life. See, the Apostle Paul spoke about his greatest treasure. Philippians 3, verse 8. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish. Dung is some translations, all right? In order that I may gain Christ. If you forget, both of these are 3:8 verses. Ephesians 3:8. To me, though I am the very least of all the saints, this grace was given to preach to the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ. So there's a man who found a treasure that exceeds all others. And here's the treasure, Christ, Jesus. Nothing can even come close to him. And the glory of him is so amazing, it's so satisfying, that everything pales in comparison. And when we divert our attention away from the Lord, our love will begin to grow cold. It's that simple. went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. It's kind of like a tongue twister. But he's saying that there'll be people that you and I will come in contact with, and they don't want any, they may have been in church, but they don't want anything to do with God, and they live that way the rest of their life. Then they were never really of us. But they went out, that it might become plain that they are all are not of us. But you have been anointed, that is where oil comes in, by the Holy One. Goes on in verses 26 and 27. It says, I write these things to you about those who are trying to deceive you. But the anointing that you receive from him abides in you, and you have no need that anyone should teach you. But as his anointing teaches you about everything, and is true, and is no lie, I'm telling you, this is throughout 1 John. This is true, this is a lie. It is no lie. Just as it has been taught you, goes back to that treasure. Abide in him. Abide in him. If you're missing it right now, if you're getting a little rusty, I want to ask you, how are you in Jesus? Have you got your eyes off of him? It's so easy. And so, remember last week when we got to the end of the story of the Wizard of Oz, the Scarecrow got his Doctor of Thinkology. So now it's the Tin Man's turn. As for you, my galvanized friend, you want a heart. You don't know how lucky you are not to have one. Hearts will never be practical until they can be made unbreakable. But I still want one. Back where I come from, there are men who do nothing all day but good deeds. They are called filler, good deed doers. And their hearts are no bigger than yours. But they have one thing you haven't got, a testimony. Therefore, in consideration of your kindness, I take pleasure at this time in presenting you with a small token of our esteem and our affection. And he hands the Tin Man a huge heart-shaped watch and chain. And remember my sentiment, that a heart is not judged by how much you love, but how much you are loved by others. I want you to notice, if you're not careful, you can take some of these things as scripture. It isn't. God doesn't say to you, I want you to live your life in such a way that you are loved a bunch by others. He wants us to live our lives loving others. The wizard's wrong, my friends. Do you realize how many people throughout history, just in the scriptures, that love people with a pure love and they were not loved by others? One in particular is the God-man, Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. Whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. There have been bunches of people who God has loved that don't love him back. And I want to encourage you at this Christmas time, there are some people in your life that are really easy to love, and then there's a bunch of people that aren't that easy. Heart toward God that would give us a heart toward others. Here's how this happens as we wrap up. Ezekiel 36, 26. And I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart. It's a work of God. It is a work of God. Jeremiah 24, verse 7. I will give them a heart to know that I am the Lord, and they shall be my people, and I will be their shall return to me with their whole heart. Isn't that good of God? He does this. It's a sovereign work of God. And what happens when that